Okay, this is the March 13th meeting of the Conway Board of Selectmen. FCAT, our local TV station, Frontier Community Access Television, is recording this meeting. Anyone else recording the meeting? No? Okay, great. First item on the agenda, the minutes of March 6th. Has everybody had a chance to review the minutes?
Look good to me.
Yeah, look good.
Yeah. Okay, look fine. All right, I'll make a motion that we accept the minutes from March 6th. Have a second?
Second it.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Meetings attended by select board members.
Well, the only meeting that all three of us really rose in the meeting, but it was a fundraiser for the tornado relief fund at the Berkshire Brewing in Deerfield. And I understand, rumor has it, that they took in a little over $4,000 toward the fund.
Really?
So I think that was great. It was a good time. I met a lot of town residents there that I hadn't seen in a long time. Mm-hmm. So it was kind of a really good thing to do, I think. And everybody gave generously, so mm-hmm. I think it was a great thing.
Well, I think, you know, Bob mentioned the fundraiser at BBC. We also had an after-action meeting last week.
Right.
That Dave and Bob did an excellent job at. And I think that a lot of what came out of that meeting will be very good for us in terms of formulating better policies and procedures for our next emergency. Hopefully that won't be for a long time, but that was a very good meeting. We had MEMA there, we had DRC there, a DCR. We had the Northwest Massachusetts Incident Management Team rep there, Bob Strand from Greenfield. And I think the contributions were great. And aside from the contributions that Trish Vincasey sent to us that I thought were very comprehensive and very good. So that meeting, I thought, went very well. And I think once we get our report from Tracy Rogers up at
FERCOG.
Readiness at FERCOG, we'll be able to hone that down and integrate it into our policies and procedures.
So. Now, every one of those guys couldn't have spoken more highly of you, Bob. Mm-hmm. You know, not that we need to plug that a lot.
No, that's enough.
But they
we do what we do.
They were very impressed. And, you know, all of them said they've been to incidents that were not handled anywhere near as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We also all went to the town caucus.
Right.
That's right. We had Monday night.
The town caucus as well.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay. And on Friday, I went to a meeting in Worcester by the MMLA, the Mass Municipal Lawyers Association, about marijuana. And to some extent, it was saying that although we have a year now to deal with marijuana, but we need to think about it and get started. And you know, we probably all know that the MMA was very opposed to the mm-hmm. passage of the marijuana question, and their lawyers association is to some extent, it's how to keep marijuana dispensaries out of your town. I mean, they're not subtle in their legal approach to how to deal with the marijuana laws.
Yeah. I also went to the legislative breakfast on Friday morning in Lenox. There were a different group of administrators there than were at the meeting in Greenfield. So we've got some more views on what's going on in terms of the budget, which we heard not too good things about, and some other information, including a pretty good talk on the marijuana law and how to basically prevent your town from, you know, getting involved in it before they're prepared to get involved.
And there are a lot of aspects to the law that aren't nailed down yet, and one of them was you have to have fewer marijuana dispensaries than you do alcohol dispensaries. And We only have one that I know of. Right? So
fewer means.
And so whether that means we can't have one or... I don't know. You know, there are things like that.
They're going to be tweaking this law quite a bit.
Yeah.
So, we have any citizens' concerns?
No.
Okay. Good. My old business. First item is climate change resolution. I guess that's this one, Tom.
That's George. Butler.
And
you would ask for an extra week to look at that.
Yeah,
right. Did you guys review this?
We did.
Yes.
Okay.
And
what would you like? Do you have a recommendation on it?
We certainly were in favor of putting, you know, if you can get it on a warrant, let the town. It's totally non-binding.
Right.
All we were feeling what we'd do is we'd say we could endorse this or encourage people to at least respond to it, not just to push it off.
Okay.
The data looks really good, what they present as a system that they think will do the job and put the money back in consumers' pockets rather than big oil or, you know, the energy people.
My concern was one thing was, what's the operational cost of the system? And I understand it's non-binding questions, it's a long ways from becoming law, but when the question is what percentage was going to cost you?
Well, this is the plus side, as it was presented to us, is that the fee will be charged at the vendor.
Mm-hmm.
The money will go into a fund.
Mm-hmm.
It gets returned to individuals based on what their energy uses are. So what it ultimately will do, reduce the individual's energy cost, and the hope for them is that this is going to reduce the amount of...
But isn't the vendor who is producing this, whatever it might be, electricity or whatever it is, aren't they going to up their cost?
That's why...
To the customer first, so we're going to pay up a higher here in anticipation of getting a check back over here?
The anticipation will be there. The system
I understand that, but I mean,
if
it was a law that they could put to pass that they couldn't surcharge you for it in advance, it'd be a wonderful law. But they're going up the increase. If they're going to pay more out of it, their pocket.
Oh, absolutely.
They're going to up it to their customers.
The fee is going to go.
So why are we? I guess my question is, where's the advantage for the homeowner, the end of the line user, to have to pay more to hopefully get a check back at the end?
Well, because how much you get back is depend on what your usage is. So
my understanding was that everybody got the same amount back.
I think that's right.
And that was part of their attempt to lessen the blow on those least able to afford it, and those who use more carbon would get the same amount back as those who used little carbon.
That's true.
All right, this is in the very initial stages.
Well, very much, yeah. There's
so your sentiment on the Energy Committee is to recommend this?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, it's an attempt at another market-based approach.
Right.
And it's being considered over many, many towns and many... Mm-hmm. Okay. And I'm sure, marijuana...
When it gets to our town meeting floor, it'll be a hot topic.
Well, yes.
What's that, Bob?
If it gets to our town meeting floor, you better hope you got a lot of answers, because there's going to be a lot of hot topics on it, I bet.
It's a long way away.
Well, it's an alternative cap and trade, mm-hmm. which they haven't been able to right. flesh out. They just haven't been able to make this work, and this is an alternate plan that has merit.
Okay.
But I think you're right. This is beginning. There's no legislation written. There's no mm-hmm. nothing, and then they're looking to see if they put this in place, what is going to be workable?
It's non-binding.
Non-binding. So
it's an initial idea.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's right.
Bob, do you have any comments?
I think if there's any town in the Commonwealth that would support this, it's us.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, okay. You know.
So then,
is that a good thing or a bad thing?
I think that's it's who we are. I mean, you know, we just had a major climate change event. And some people might not believe that the tornado was caused by by global warming or climate change, but I do, so.
Okay, so is the sentiment of the board to recommend that we put this on the town meeting warrant?
I would vote for it, yeah.
I guess non-binding, so.
I'll make a motion that we put the resolution for federal and state carbon fee and dividend, a resolution relating to the growing risks of climate change, on the, and this is a non-binding resolution. We'll put this on the town warrant. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
Aye.
I love hearing you being recorded saying that, John.
Oh, you do?
Yeah.
Which particular phrase?
I'm sorry.
Okay.
We're all friends here.
I thought we were.
No, you're on tape right there.
Oh, okay. And you are?
I'm John Cordes.
Hey, John O'Rourke. Pleasure. Nice. Thanks for coming in.
Yep. I'm John Robert Baker.
Hi.
Yeah. And Bob Armstrong. Okay, before we get to closing the warrant, we'll listen to what John has to say first. So we'll move that up on the agenda. John, you're here for the Anti-Corruption Act resolution, is that
yes.
correct?
Yes. Okay. And do you have some of the information already?
We have this. This is all we have.
Oh, okay. All right.
Do you have the actual resolution?
There is a resolution which I brought. You guys can take a look at it, but it's
make some copies.
It's a non-binding resolution, and this is coming out of a national group called Represent.us, which is interesting because it's a nonpartisan group.
Mm-hmm.
Don't necessarily belong to any particular political group or political party.
George, we just put your resolution on the warrant.
Beautiful. You missed it, George.
I knew it. Yeah. Well,
we were too quick for you, George.
Pardon me?
It's recorded so you can watch it after the meeting's over. And
yeah.
Okay. Thank you,
John. Thank you.
Thank you.
So there's this group called Represent.us, and they're interested in trying to clean up some of the money that's in politics and dominating what many people believe to be a lot of the decisions that are made. There's a local Represent Us group, Western Mass, Represent.us Western Mass, and our Franklin County post Bernie Sanders campaign group called Franklin County CPR. One of our working groups is working on campaign finance reform. So I'm really coming to you and coming to the town kind of as a representative of the Franklin County CPR group. But we've adopted this, we're kind of not reinventing the wheel. We're borrowing this from Represent Us.
Mm-hmm.
And this is kind of a model resolution. But their strategy and our strategy is to work with them, is to get as many of the towns in the Commonwealth who actually have a town meeting structure to pass these non-binding resolutions. And if we can get enough towns to do this, to, you know, as a symbol of popular support, then our representatives in the state can use this as kind of like a political leverage, or you know, part of their argument to try to work towards passing. Which I know there are two bills currently under proposal in the state legislature. One in the House and one in the Senate, that are looking at campaign finance reform. So this is really kind of like a local effort to try to support things on a state level.
Mm-hmm.
And it would be, you know, I guess to just take a simple vote at the town meeting to see if people like what this says and if they want to throw their weight behind it.
Now you're proposing to take all funding out of the political system to support candidates, or?
No. Okay. It's this Anti-Corruption Act, which is, I think, the specific template on which they're working from, is more of reforming the system. I don't think that they are going to take all the financing out of things, but there's...
You're going to limit the financing, maybe?
They're going to limit, they're going to hopefully increase the transparency. They're going to hopefully change some of the rules about the period of time that someone can go into lobbying after they've been in a government position, things like that.
That's a good idea.
So instead of 2 years, it becomes 5 years, that kind of stuff. So yeah. I actually can't quote, you know, all of the things in the act, but I've looked at it. It looks like it's a pretty reasonable place to kind of start on this. Mm. And God knows, you know, where this would end up going. I know these kind of efforts have been mounted in the past, and not a whole lot has changed. But I think it's important to try to do this. I was very chagrined to read the op-ed piece that was in the New York Times from the retiring chairman of the Federal Elections Commission, which was started back in the Nixon era, because there was so much corruption at that point that had been exposed. Mm-hmm. And there's this group that, you know, has been going on for a long time, and it's basically been completely ineffective. Mm-hmm. And so I'm sort of sanguine about this, but I do feel like there's such a groundswell now of interest in trying to work on things and to improve our system that I think it's timely. So I'm hoping that we can...
Yeah, well, I think most people would agree that political campaigns are too long, they spend much too much money, and where they get their money from may not be the best places. So, you know, I certainly think the sentiment of this would be acceptable to most people. You guys have comments?
So this is the first time, you know, I mean, there are these two things that we're voting on today, and I'm a new selectman, so I don't know, you know, is there a precedent on what I base my vote on? Is it what I personally believe? I can say, yes, this matches my personal belief, but I don't...
All we're doing is putting this on the town warrant to allow residents to vote on it.
That's all. We're not voting on it.
We're just voting to put it on the warrant.
As a constituent, I would encourage you to support that.
But I could imagine this. I mean, maybe I'm a gambler and I like gambling, and I would want to have something on the warrant that would, you know, promote gambling, whereas it might not be good for the town. I don't know how to weigh my vote, although I don't mind saying what I personally believe.
What we're doing is putting this out to the vote of the residents.
You will have an opportunity to recommend or not recommend each item that is on the agenda. We're not at that stage yet.
Okay.
But each of the warrant articles does contain whether or not there's a recommendation. So you could have a no recommendation, or you could have a vote 3-0 to
warrant that. But in the case of the one we just passed, and this one here, if we prove that, I don't think we should have a recommend or not recommend by the Board of Selectmen.
Again, that's a future discussion.
And should we left up, we're just place setting it for the people to look at.
That's
all we're doing.
Sure.
Right.
And I don't think we should.
That could be.
You'll
be voting on that.
Right. Yeah.
There will be a discussion.
Mm-hmm. So. Any other questions for Mr. Cordes?
Are there any other towns that are doing this, or are we going to be the only one?
Because
I haven't heard of other towns talking about it.
I don't know.
I mean, I appreciate your initiative.
In Western Mass, I've been in touch with the person in Boston who's spearheading this for the Represent Us group.
Yeah.
And I know that there are people in the eastern part of the state. I had hoped to talk to someone from Asheville to see if they could get that on for their meeting. but I think the time is short. Like, I just, this kind of slipped in right under the wire in terms of the time requirement. So there might not be too many towns this particular town meeting cycle.
Yeah, just one.
At least in Western Mass.
Any other questions? Okay, I think that the basic idea here is a good one. We're talking about a non-binding article, and I think the residents of the town should have a choice of voting on this.
I agree.
Okay, I'll make a motion that we put this non-binding article and or non-binding resolution, and are we calling it this the anti-corruption resolution? Or what are we calling this? Do we have a name for it? I know in your initial...
I'm not sure the...
The agenda item says Resolution in Support of Anti-Corruption Act.
Okay.
Yes. Because it's interesting, because I'm not sure if you were to call it simply a campaign finance reform resolution.
Okay, let's call it a campaign finance reform resolution. Okay.
Okay.
All right. Because not all...
I think that's
not
more
all,
immediately recognizable. People know that phrase, I think.
Not all contributions are corruption. Right?
No.
Okay.
And there's a lot of corruption that's not anti... that has nothing to do with campaign finance.
That's true, Bob.
So we're not,
that's very true.
Anti-corruption is pretty
just
broad.
You that out pretty
yeah.
well.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, I'll make a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Cordes.
Yeah, thanks.
Appreciate
so
your help on that.
Yeah.
Thanks for bringing it in.
Thanks a lot. And thank you, all of you, for all the work that you did after the storm. I really was impressed with how that was handled.
We had an awful lot of help from an awful lot of people, including state agencies and our local incident management team, and it just, you know, it went well. Thank God, no one got hurt.
Yeah,
We have a great firemen's group. Yeah, all the
well, not just firemen.
We have
police.
A healthy group
police.
Of firemen and town employees.
Yeah,
police. Yeah. All our local folks, in addition to the state
right.
people.
Thanks.
You're welcome
have
to stay.
Have a good night.
It's a riveting meeting here.
Thank you.
Good.
Okay. Okay. The next item on the agenda is Tom.
You want
to discuss closing the warrant?
Well, I have some general items on the.
You want to run them? The other articles through? You here for the other articles?
Yeah.
Yeah,
the
two.
You want to run them through first? Spend some time with Tom. We'll have them have rush
things. You know, they probably won't hear this.
Oh, I don't want to.
But you know what? We'll move on. Just in case they don't.
I just feel funny. <funny. laughs>
Thank you, Robert.
I see through it when it's time to tomorrow.
I have no reason to watch it.
My in-depth analysis is...
Peter and Sue, you guys are next. We've got a proposal for the
two of them actually.
Okay. Which one are we going to discuss first?
Right. Well,
I gave you all my copies.
Agenda.
So.
That's the agenda. So we've got those two things.
So the PV squared and Cordes.
Which one do you want first?
Goss.
And
Goss.
Dr. John. Which one is that first?
This is the proposal for the interior insulation and air sealing on the town hall. And this was done as the other projects came in way beyond our funding.
This is the Goss proposal?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
And what has taken some time is to try to keep paring this down to money that we had in the Green Energy Grant to do this, so it took a lot of back and forth.
So now your insulation's on the inside rather than on the outside?
We're not. The wall insulation isn't...
in here at all?
Isn't in here at all. What this is the attic portion of removing the insulation in the second floor ceiling, air sealing and putting insulation back in. And I do believe they're going to be reusing the insulation that's there and then adding to it to get the R value up where they want it.
What's the R value now?
I think there's probably 6 or 8 inches of, I think it's chopped mineral wool that's up there now. So we're looking at maybe an R 15 at the most.
Okay. And what is it going to be when they finish?
I think they'll go to an R 30. I don't know if it's told us there, but I think that's what code is for. They're going to put 12 inches of loose fill in there, plus there's 2 inches of spray foam. Spray foam's going to give an R value of probably 10 or 12.
That's on the base?
That's the base. That's going to seal that second floor ceiling. They're going to take out the stove vent in the kitchen's going to be removed, and that wall sealed. They're going to insulate the heat supply pipes that are in the trenches. And that boiler got put in. They're done in the equipment room where the boiler is, but right, they haven't moved out further. And that's going to get done.
Before you go on any further, talking about heating the pipes, I had a conversation with Ken Romat, who's been our plumber for years. He thinks that this trench piping insulation is wasting the taxpayers' dollars. And the main reason is because they're all plastic pipes. They've all been converted to plastic pipes now. And he felt that that's inside the building packet, not outside the building packet. And he felt that if you could do a cost analysis on it to show you what the savings was going to be from not insulating them to insulating them, he thinks the cost of doing it is going to be way more than the savings is.
The only way I can respond to that is the engineer that scoped this says this is what is code for. And hot water systems work on high temperature water. The more heat you lose in the trench, the less gets into the building, because the radiators don't function as well because the water has been cooled getting there.
Are they going to insulate the water piping to the toilets and stuff also?
That's not part of this project. We're looking at, this is energy upgrades.
We're transporting heating down them, one of them pipes, right? Hot water.
Well, that would be another program. I mean, it's not part of the contract that we wrote. It's not part of what the green energy proposal we initially sent in was to do.
So this is just strictly for heating?
Just for heating.
I mean, what better time would it have been to do them all with the guys right there? You know what I mean?
Well, I grant it. And I would have thought that a professional tradesman, when they did that, that's what would have been done. They also have to be rehung because the intervals of hanging do not meet code, which is the other piece they're going to do. Unfortunately, gone are the days where, you know, you got a bunch of people together and you got a bucket of paint and brushes and you went and go did the job and everybody was happy. Mm-hmm. Now the codes are going to continually...
Are these pipes visible? I mean, are they accessible? I mean the hot water pipe that goes to the bathroom.
I don't know how much of those. I know they go down that trench.
Uh-huh.
So that's
I mean, at home, I just bought insulation and wrap around and,
right,
you know, wrap
but
it around the pipe.
As Bob said, it certainly would not be, it would be worth, again, doing that.
Yeah.
But we were not able to keep adding, and it wasn't pointed out. What we got was an initial analysis from the engineer on where we could make a difference in the energy footprint of that building.
Well, his comment basically was he don't feel that $14,100, you're ever going to get recovered that in energy cost savings. That's what's
well,
I that's only what I'm being told.
Not uncommon. He's got plenty of company. I know a lot of plumbers that don't insulate heat pipes. They don't even heat ducts. And then the companies that do that come in after they're done and make their money doing that because it needs to be done.
So this proposal came to us from Lily Barrick?
Lily did the initial, all the engineering work. set up, and she and Matt Goss have been going back and forth trying to get the cost where we can get the most work done for what we have to spend. And the other thing that we felt was after we got pushback on the exterior insulation and ran out of time frame, actually, and thought this might be a good way to actually do what we're going to do here, see what sort of results we get. Generally, the stopping the heat flow in a vertical direction is easier to do than trying to, and more effective than trying to get it from going out the sidewall. Mm-hmm. This may very well give us a good recovery on energy cost there, where it may not be as necessary to look at doing the exterior walls. But we won't know that till we've had that in there for a season or two and see what it does to build.
What are they doing with the sizes of the beams upstairs in the gymnasium, where you've got that 1-inch gap on both sides of the beams?
That's all going to be air sealed.
Because it doesn't say that in here anywhere. That I could.
Top gym walls. I know they're doing it, and I...
That's a, above the tiles. That tile, they see they're going to move, that's way up high. I'm
right.
Talking right down from the base of the floor up through. Does they call it stuffing the insulation in the core?
To the best of my knowledge, that's in here, but how it's described, I can't say.
Because that's a very important factor. You go upstairs, I don't care if you go up there tonight, walk up there right now, and the breeze coming in there is horrendous around them beams. And you got a terrific inflow of cold air.
Mm-hmm. Well, that was the first thing they were doing, is air sealing was the big piece.
Mm-hmm.
So I can say with fair confidence that's a piece of this. That it will be done.
That it will be done. Your guarantee is that?
You want my firstborn child?
I'm just saying. I mean, we're spending some sizable money here, and it's not energy grant money, but
without calling Lily and verifying that, I won't tell you 100% that I'm certain it's there. But I know that it was part of this. I know the air sealing was why. And I'm trying to remember the conversation. We've been on this so long.
They may be calling it something that we're not recognizing here, too, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So it would be in the section of top gym walls, right? I mean,
it would be in with gym walls, I would think.
Yeah.
It could be to stuff the insulation in the core.
Yeah.
That could be part of it.
I mean, I don't know what's a dowel board, 2.5-inch dowel board?
That's the boarding that's on there now. They're going to...
Because they say seal top and bottom of the dowel board. I don't know what dowel means.
Isn't that dowel board that new ceiling we had put up a few years ago in there? I'm guessing.
Maybe I'm not.
Somewhere in here says they're going to remove the dowel board, if I remember correctly.
Right, yeah.
And re-emplace it afterwards.
Right.
I read that correctly somewhere in here.
Right, yeah, they're going to air seal that entire perimeter. Mm-hmm. That's why they're pulling the tile and anything that you pull down that wall and what they've got to fill there.
Well, other than what Mr. comments from somebody else about the trench pipes, I guess I'll back this if you guarantee me that space is going to be taken care of.
Well, I can't.
You know, you can't.
At this moment. I mean, I can certainly get you the information. I mean, I can verify that.
Because if that's not getting done, you're kind of wasting your energy. That's one of the most important things to start with, way down low. It pours right in there.
Well, that's what's getting sealed up above it, the attic.
Yep.
I mean, you're sealing it at the top.
Mm. Oh, another question I had. Was this put out for bid? This portion of it?
Oh, absolutely.
You got three quotes?
This is a change order to the already signed contract that went out to bid.
And that's legal to do?
Yeah. We didn't go over 10% of the original one. Going under is fine if the contractor agrees with it, which he's prepared to do.
And that's in the procurement laws, right?
Yeah.
So it is legal.
That's it's just a change order.
Yeah, we had a contract with him to do this, which included which was the outside stuff.
But he was going to do a lot more for a lot more money.
Right, and that's the outside stuff is what he got hired to do. And when we said we're not going to be able to do this,
I want to have Tom tell us that it passes the big camera laws.
Yeah, yeah.
That's all I'm concerned about. Yeah,
we're fine as far as that's concerned.
Okay.
No, I'm good.
Shut up now. That's enough.
I think it's a great idea.
Okay. And this comes at the recommendation of our Energy Committee?
It does.
Okay. And you're confident that that Lily covered all the bases in her analysis?
I have one question. The $83,811, when that's spent and we've paid off Lily, do you know how much more we're going to have left in the original grant? It seems to me we're going to have 10 or 20,000.
Is not being spent.
Is not being spent.
Right, but I mean the 81.
The 81.
Yeah.
How much is left in that account?
Yeah, I think it'll be something like $20,000.
About 20, a little more.
Wasn't it only had like 104 right now or something like that?
So just in case we needed a third change order. To add something, we can take care of it within the grant.
But we needed to get this done and spent, or we're going to run out of our extension on the money.
Right.
Would
right.
make it difficult to apply again, which mm-hmm. we'd like to do.
Yeah. Any other questions for Peter?
I wonder about the garage doors. Are they done?
Not a piece of this.
I know it's not a piece of this. I was just wondering about that in general. But
it's coming, but it's not going to happen. Well, I spoke with Ron, and I know about it is that we thought we might be able to use green energy money to get that in, but he'd already had this thing going, so we couldn't.
Okay. Oh, I see.
Jump funding from that to help him out. Sounds like once the weather gets better, where they can keep that building open enough to, because it's going to have the front of that thing teared up, so you're going to need to have it, warm enough. So.
Yep. Don't worry about them.
So I would say probably May before they start that, unless you know any more about that, Bob, than I do.
No, I can't.
Stay away.
Ask me that tomorrow. We'll extend a little further.
Okay, any other questions for Peter?
Good.
All right, and this is an amendment to the contract we already signed, and it's less than we approved before. I'll make a motion that we approve
on it, John?
The amendment. Yeah, that's the 81880.
Yep.
Approve this contract amendment number one to the contract we originally signed. For the installation and heating improvements of the town hall. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Nine.
Aye.
Thank you.
There's one down.
I got an agenda back.
Thank you.
I think I have an extra copy if you want.
The second piece is a contract to develop design criteria for the solar farm. This went out. We got four bids today. Mm-hmm. PV Square was the lowest bid, and there was a considerable range of what came in. We backed PV Square for two reasons. One, that their bid was the best number. They're local. They have an engineer on staff. If this goes out, we have to make drawings that have to go out for an RFP. They'd have to have an engineer stamp on it. So it doesn't mean we've got to send out or engage another agency to to look at this. The reason we went this way is the engineering aspects of laying this out were beyond certainly the members of the committee. The agency that we contacted to do the initial feasibility of this and went through the financing and said whether this is feasible, what it's going to cost, doesn't really do that piece of it. We could have hired somebody to done the whole RFP and the engineering at one thing, but that got even more expensive. Peter Rosnick found out that we can get, I think it's the COG will do the RFPs for considerably less than again, the numbers that we were getting from other people. So, once again, we went with...
The numbers are all over the place, which is...
Yeah, it was crazy. They went from...
It's like a new industry, and it almost hasn't shaken out.
Yeah. This went down. Yeah, their fee was, you know, $1,250. I think Co-op Power came in at $6,000, and they're in between, but all essentially offering the same thing.
And this is essentially just for the design of just the solar field.
A one-line drawing. This is going to be, you know, panels, equipment, you know, just to specify.
Just going to specify location?
No, the location is still... We've got our proposed location.
Because you've been following the articles with the senior housing group, and they are now looking at that area, or going to be looking at that area also.
But they'll work around where
we've walked
this
around
is.
Together.
Yeah.
So we've got a chunk of property that's big enough to accommodate.
Well, I understand that, but you people always were talking when you wanted it close to the school.
Well, no, we didn't specify whereabout on that lot. Is the original drawings that were done up by the consulting firm that we got, that's where they placed it, because what we had given them for criteria was that we needed to leave space in that field for a possible expansion of the school and the possible need to replace the septic system. That's why it got placed where it was there. And also, again, you get into some train issues and stuff as you move back, it doesn't necessarily make it undoable, but they were looking at getting as close as they could to the line to cut down on distances.
But he's going to be putting a cost estimate together, correct, for the engineers?
This is not a cost estimate.
They've given a preliminary cost estimate.
Yes, they'll give us a ball, you know.
Because if you were to push it back for the accommodation for senior housing, it would be more costly. Well, I do understand it, because of the simple fact you got to come back further from the grid that you're going to be tying into. So
this is primarily to get so that we can take this engineering thing and they can develop an our request for proposals from other vendors.
So then vendors would come in and actually bid on what they would charge to build this.
Yeah. This narrows down what we're asking people to do, so that we're not getting apples and oranges kind of comparison between various vendors.
So this mentioned a couple times a one-line drawing. I don't know what that means. What's a one-line drawing?
Well, rather than showing, you know, the 27 cables that are going to come from the array out someplace, there'll be a single line that represents interconnects, and the same thing with equipment. You're not going to get, you know, photographic images of equipment.
Okay.
You're going to get line drawings that say this is, you know.
Okay.
And their general criteria for the equipment, not specific. Because when bids go out, it's going to be such and such or equivalent.
So yeah, this gives us the design and the specifications so we can go out to bid.
That's exactly.
When does this, at what point do we bring this back to the taxpayers?
This is
their vote.
Well, we go to the taxpayers when we want to borrow $700,000 or whatever it is, right?
Isn't this some of that Medigrant money, is it not?
Well, the Medigrant money is only going to pay for the design and the RFP.
So the Medigrant's paying for
the
this
Medigrant
portion of it.
Will pay for
yes.
this.
Yes.
Yeah.
So for this portion of it.
Yeah. So we already have that money set aside.
This is $1,248.
So we're only voting for the $1,248?
Yes.
No?
Correct.
Yeah.
That's right.
And that's with the Medigrant money. Okay.
Yeah.
Because eventually we got to go to town meeting with this thing if it goes far enough.
Absolutely.
Well, yeah, if we go out for an RFP
we
have to go to town meeting, sure.
Yeah, we can't ask for a request for proposals unless we've got the funding to.
Right.
I thought we were going to put the $700,000 on your credit card.
And we all understand
that
we won't be ready for this town meeting.
No.
Yeah, that's not good. We're not.
There's no way you can get this on town meeting now because we're closing the thing tonight. So.
Well, no, we knew that we were just the process was going to get more.
Well, this is one more step closer, but passing this tonight will have nothing to do with
anything basically
with the warrant.
Right.
right?
That's right.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's right.
Okay. Any other questions for Peter? Okay. We can't go any further with this until we get our design and specs, and this is the first step.
Yep.
And I think for what they're going to give us, this is going to be reasonable. This is
$1,200 is reasonable.
Okay. We got four bids, and you know, this looks like the best one according to the Energy Committee. So I'll make a motion that we approve the agreement with PV squared for the $1,248 to give us a design and specifications for the community solar field. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
John, do you know where the name PV squared comes from? I love it. Pioneer Valley Photovoltaic.
Oh, that's the two PVs? Oh, good. Yeah.
That's where the squared comes in.
Uh-huh.
Pioneer Valley Photovoltaic. I like that.
Okay. Like a scientist there?
Yeah. All right.
I like the fact that they're a greenfield company.
Well, I've heard good things about it.
Yeah, absolutely.
Definitely an advocate of.
We are lucky to
get people local if they're available and qualified.
Yeah.
Now, you guys can stay for the rest of the meeting if you want.
That's okay. I've had more fun than I can say. No disrespect intended, Peter.
I can understand that.
My coffee is running out.
Thanks for coming.
Thanks so much, folks. Appreciate
you. Thanks for coming in, Sue.
Thank you.
And thanks for all the work you guys are doing.
It's fun, actually. It's a good committee.
You've got a loose chair here.
Guys, have a good night.
Thank you.
You too.
You're giving back an answer on that, right? From them?
What's that?
On the petition inside the deans?
Yes.
Good. Thank you.
For sure.
Appreciate it.
Okay, the next item is the amended contract for community action. Tom, would you give us the lowdown on this?
Several years ago, the Energy Committee, especially Sue Bridge, promoted a cooperative effort with community action to provide weatherization services to people who were getting fuel assistance, thinking that rather than just giving them money for fuel and houses that were drafty, it would make more sense if people who were getting fuel assistance also had weatherization done to their houses. We had 3 years of $30,000 that we gave from the Guilford Fund, and Community Action matched that with their funding.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That program has now run its course, and they don't see any reason to continue asking for funds from the town right now, so we're actually wrapping that up. The contract actually ended December 31st, 2016, and so in order to give them money, we need to amend the contract so that it continues through the current time. And
so they've got bills that haven't been paid yet, evidently, or something?
Well, our agreement to give them $30,000 is...
We have not given them the money yet?
We have not given them the money because the contract ran out before we got invoiced for it. So we just need to extend the period so that we can pay them the money we've already agreed to give them. Then if they, whatever money they don't spend ends up coming back to the town. But I think they have a list of people
to spend. Do you know how much of it we
spend
have spent?
I don't know that.
And was that a town meeting vote?
No, that was,
that,
a,
money?
That was a select board vote because it was... It was a trust fund, which is, and you're all trustees of the trust fund.
Is this Mass Save? Is it
still money in there right now?
Pitched as Mass
Save? Oh yeah,
no.
So it's had a different program.
No, this is a unique program, a public-private partnership. As far as I know,
few people have used it in town.
The only one in the area.
Hmm.
So, as far as I know, the only one anywhere. But
is this the one the Energy Committee has a funny name for?
This is Cozy 2.
Okay, yeah, I hear them talk about it. Cozy 2.
Yeah, we're just extending the time period on this. We've already...
So people who want to participate could still participate? people that have not.
Well, they got to hurry and get in. It's all over this April.
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe they may be.
They got just a little over a month.
They may be waiting to pay bills from the last amount that they have. I don't know what their financial situation is or where the program stands. This is just a structural effort to make it possible to give them the money that we've already given them.
I see.
Because according to our last contract, it's over.
So this tells me that this contract is going to be all done April 30th?
Yes, well, we'll give them the check immediately upon signing this. We actually made it out before and then realized it was caught by our eagle-eyed treasurer.
Have you received expenditure accounts coming back to show that the money's been spent the way it went?
There was an update that they gave last year when they came in and talked about it. We have not had an update since then. I'm sure they'd be happy to come in and talk about the program.
Well, I think if we got a check, you ought to see where your money's gone.
Well, again, we've already agreed to give them this money. We can get an accounting for it when they've used this to wrap up their project. And
I'd like to see that.
I'm happy to ask them in.
They don't need to put names on it, just how it's been spent.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Don't you
remember? No? Sure, I'd love to have them come in and talk to them. I think it's a great program.
Any other questions? Okay. I'll make a motion that we amend the contract with Community Action to extend the period of time to the end of April for our for the monies that we already approved for them. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
To me, it sounds like we didn't do as good a job as we could have promoting it. I don't make you know, that may, and maybe they promote it. I don't.
Well, it's only $60,000 worth of work, so I mean, it doesn't take a lot of money or work to get rid of $60,000 nowadays. I wouldn't think, you know. I think it was for. I think one of them for. One that was used in Conway. I think they replaced somebody's furnace in their home. I think. It was one of them, I think, if I remember correctly.
Tom, do you want to talk to us about the budget and closing the warrant?
I would love to talk about that.
Okay.
And the warrant in general. This is, that's just that. A few notes on Article 2, as it was presented in the budget, not as it appears in the one you have in front of you, but in this budget, which has the key figure saying that we can do things in the black, which is very important.
Yeah, the hell.
On the revenue side, we now have an estimate of 24,000 in new growth rather than 20,000. It might go up 1,000 or two, but that's another 4,000. That's good. In case you didn't notice, the budget leaves 30,332 in free cash unspent as a hedge against contingencies such as those listed below in the expense side, as well as any last-minute increases in school budgets and any other higher-than-projected expenses, unexpected expenses, things like that. So really we have a total of $34,332 and we can still be in the black. However, we should not try to spend all of that. And I have a hunch that some of the things in the budget may not be funded entirely once you talk with the Finance Committee about funding levels and what it means for tax rates. On the expense side, again, this is all having to do with the budget. These let me just make sure. Yes, these figures have been corrected in the warrant you have, the draft warrant you have here. Building maintenance wages should be an extra $3,000. There are budget worksheets in the text. I'm sorry?
What was that extra $3,000 for?
It was just a copying error. These are just sort of miscellaneous errata.
Okay.
And for some reason, I didn't get the full amount of highway expenditures into that article too. Again, it's correct in the budget worksheet in the text, but it should match, and it should be the higher figure, $260.33. I believe we should raise the Council on Aging budget, which comes under 540 series here. It's combined with the veterans under Human Services. They were recently, for foot care, they were recently approved for that amount from the reserve fund, though they did not submit it in their budget. So my sense is that it's a successful program. They'll want to continue it, and we should probably just fund it rather than having them ask for it from the reserve fund again. I have not talked with Pat Lynch about that, but that's a thought I had going forward.
Very successful, I guess, from listening to everything they say about it.
Mm-hmm. And I had originally thought we could take $2,000 off my original budget, as the wastewater engineering and design was going to come from community preservation funds, and that was my original estimate, the $2,000. However, our accountant has checked with the State Department of Revenue and found that the projected historic preservation and open space benefits are not sufficiently central to the request for open space and historic preservation funds to be used for that purpose. So, we have before us again the question of possible borrowing, which more recent figures would indicate would cost $1,100. Altogether, the expense side is $10,300 more than is in the budget, and it is still safely within the $34,332 allowable. But again, it's not like we want to spend any more than that if we can avoid it.
Lowering that down to 24.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And I will also say that it's not really 24. It's more like 10, depending on what the 10 or 15, depending on what the Finance Committee decides on a cost of living adjustment.
Right.
And that's all discussed in the budget.
Mm-hmm.
So there's still there are other things that have to do with this that are also in the budget. So the final figure, including the COLA condition, is depending on what they go for. 2% would be 15,000 left, 2.5% would be 10,000 left. And that's about where we were last year, and it made me really nervous. So, mm-hmm. I we're okay, but I did want to make those notes, mm-hmm. bring those to your attention. For the warrant itself, this now still does not have on it a separate article for borrowing for wastewater design and engineering, because I had taken that out before.
Mm-hmm.
It could come back in. It had been on the warrant.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it's actually in the warrant under community preservation at this point, so that change has yet to be made in this, depending on what the Select Board and Finance Committee think about putting that on the warrant. Again, this Article 5 mentions $75,000 for this capital stabilization account. In the budget, I propose putting $50,000 from general stabilization into capital stabilization. Right now, general stabilization has about $400,000 in it. And that kind of transfer would be possible. I would like to see a continued investment in capital,
mm-hmm.
Capital stabilization.
So that's just a transfer, that's not a raise and appropriate then?
No.
Right, this should be raising and appropriating the 75 and transferring the 50. It would still be a two-thirds vote, because it's a stabilization fund. The grammar school is the same, the capital expenses for the grammar school are the same, capital improvements for Frontier is the same, $20,000 for general stabilization is the same. Again, that's $20,000 that we may or may not want to put there. There's a healthy amount in general stabilization. I do like to propose a little bit for it each year, just because it's good to, you know, a penny saved is a, you know. If you put in a little bit now and a little bit later, then pretty soon it adds up. But then there's the $20,000 for the hydraulic boom lift for the highway department, $3,000 for a hard pack for the office parking lot, $2,500 for the conversion of assessor software, all of that's the same as it was. Repurposing some of the money from the... Oh, yeah, so that's the end of really spending from raising and appropriating or other funds. Then there's repurposing money for Frontier. There's putting money from ambulance receipts into their stabilization fund and from ambulance receipts into their operating expenses. Again, we also have $15,000 in the Article 2 for the ambulance, as we usually do.
Right.
$5,000 for the next recertification of property values. Again, in the past, that's been the $7,000 for the triennial revaluation. It's more now it's a 5-year program and it has to be certified each year. So really this is a more accurate way to phrase it. But it's that same article for the assessors that is a little bit every year. The library amount.
How often will the $5,000, or will that be every other year?
No, that's every year for 5 years.
Every year, right?
Yeah.
She explained it to us. Was it last week or 2 weeks ago?
Yeah.
Article 17, we are required to appropriate some money for the local library every year in order to get state certification. The bill from a previous fiscal year for $90. I put in Article 19 just as a placeholder in case we needed money for work related to the tornado. I don't think we need this warrant article at this point. I wouldn't mind leaving it on for a minute until,
we can leave it down to the wire or something.
We see. Until we see what our total expenses are when that's added up. And then there's the community preservation article. They have a number of items that they are proposing. The first is more open space money for invasive species control. The second, again, is the wastewater committee's proposal. And the town accountant and DOR do think that the purpose is far enough removed from historic preservation and open space that they would not recommend that's an allowable expense.
So B is coming out?
B, it'll get refunded some other way.
B should come out, and then the question is, I had it before as a borrowing article.
Right.
We can put it on again that way and see how that looks. But it'll only be $1,100 to borrow, not the $2,000 I had before. Then there's the old schoolhouse, which of course would also be subject to the historic preservation restriction. I'll have something to say about that later in my report. And then their usual administrative amount. Below are the amounts we expect to get from taxes, and that should be matched at a relatively high percentage by the state. We never, you know, they say 100%, but I don't think it has been recently. But it'll be the highest percentage possible.
There is a rumor that there may not be any issue.
There may not be any. Okay.
Anyway,
any match.
Yeah. Ouch.
Yeah, well, ouch is right.
Well, you know, they said that at the beginning that eventually it was going to go away.
State budget
state money
is
going away on that.
Under a lot of pressure right now. Article 21, again, repurposing already appropriated money. I still don't have the final text to the right to farm bylaw. Jason did come in here and discuss that with you.
What was the repurposing on the element for, John? Tom?
This is now simply for other improvements to the town field area. I had it more specific than that, and the people who were in charge of the ball field said, I was focusing on the basketball court and tennis court, and the people in charge of the ball field said, hey, wait a minute, we could use some of that for all that soil that was brought in and put in like that. So I just made it much broader as far as that goes. So Jason went over the right to farm bylaw. We saw that earlier, and I just don't have the final text to insert in the warrant here. This next one is what is changing the setbacks, and there are really two parts of it. Article 23 and 24 go together, but they amend two different parts of the protective bylaws. The first part amends the body, and the second part amends the definitions. And I've put them in as two different articles just to be clear about what's going on. They're complicated enough, and I thought if we split it into two, that would be good.
Well, the first one, 23, they're just adding this accessory buildings to it, right?
We're creating a new type of building
to the setbacks, the clearances.
Yeah, that's all they're doing now.
Yeah, and but there are new terms that they use, and I put those in a different article because it's amending a different section of the bylaws. Mm-hmm. It wouldn't make any sense to vote 23 and not vote 24, but 24 is just definitions. So if that comes, if they don't vote 23. Then we can pass over 24.
Yeah,
we don't need
it. Doesn't make any difference. Yeah.
So I thought it was just clearer making it two different articles.
Okay.
For Article 25, this is for senior housing and goes on for a long time. Mm. This is the big one. It goes on all the way to page 10, almost to the bottom of page 10.
Who proposed that?
Well, this is in order to be able to allow a senior housing project, because right now it wouldn't be allowed in Conway.
Is that right?
Because you can only have two dwelling units. Mm-hmm. You can only have a duplex on a single lot.
So, in order for the planning board to have approved that last project we had in the works.
This would have
been voted first.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
I get it. So did these come from FERCOG? Who generated all of this?
I don't know the history of it.
Wasn't the planning board?
Wow.
Yes.
I'm sure there's a model for this out there.
It must be a statewide model or something, huh?
Yeah.
This is already so complicated that the definitions are part of the same section. So
Here they are.
I just made it, so that's just one article. Then there's the federal and state carbon fee and dividend one, and then there's the other resolution. I just stuck them in I was prepared to take them out, but they're in now. So, the only thing now that we're lacking then is the right to farm text, changing the wastewater approach, see if people want to borrow for that, and final numbers for Article 2, depending on what the Finance Committee recommends and you approve for COLAs.
Right, okay.
So, pretty good shape.
Yeah, we're in good shape. Yeah. All right,
very
good.
What's our, do we have a meeting scheduled, one more meeting with them next?
We have Wednesday night.
Wednesday
night at 6 o'clock.
The school committee.
The school and the finance committee.
And the superintendent will be there.
I'm not, when we're going to finalize this, that's not Wednesday night, right?
No, we have several weeks to work on the warrant.
Yeah, we just want to...
But we do want to close it tonight.
Yes,
Really, Thursday was the last day, according to the bylaws, that people can submit things for it.
Mm-hmm.
But a formal closing
of it, a formal vote,
is a good thing.
So we can close it without just the little bit that's left.
Right. Yeah, we're just closing it from people giving us more
articles.
Okay, I'll make a motion we close the warrant tonight. I have a second.
Second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Okay, next item, distribution of to town residents of tornado-related donations.
Yeah,
Is Heidi going to be in, or?
No, we don't need to have further discussion from last week. I had originally thought there was
just in case
discussion.
There was. Okay, so that's moot at this point. We have no items not anticipated 48 hours in advance?
Not that I know of.
Okay. Do you have another update, Tom? Or?
I do. Okay. General update here. I've been doing lots of emergency-related work, not unsurprisingly. And working on the possibility of a sub-regional ICS 100-700 training if we can get 20 people signed up. MEMA will do it for us if we can get 20 people. I've asked, and this is, you know, aside from the FERCOG doing it on the Monday night.
They say they got one coming up here, right?
Yeah, the next two Monday nights.
I'm already signed up for that.
And right. I've signed up for that as well. Because I need a refresher. It's been 5 years.
So will that depend upon 20 people, or is that?
Yeah.
Definitely...
No. The FERCOG's all ready to go.
Okay.
Yeah. I've asked Deerfield, Buckland, and Goshen if they might be interested. I had a bad email for Goshen, so I've got to try them again. But there's preliminary great interest. People thought that the highway crews also ought to get the 100-700 training, so they were aware of the environment that they were operating.
Oh, I think they took it.
Okay. Well, not everybody in Buckland and Deerfield has taken it. So.
Well, maybe you stand corrected. I know we took it. Adam took it. I took it. And maybe the other guys in the highway that took it originally, the very first time, have all gone now.
So oh, okay. Well, and again, this will be a...
His son have taken it yet, and Jay don't think it's taken it.
Mm-hmm.
But we offered it when we originally did it in town the very first time we offered it to the highway department, fire, police, the ambulance.
Excellent.
And we did a whole bunch of us at once. Did it.
Excellent. Yeah, I'm thinking of a daytime training so highway staff could attend as part of their regular hours.
Nothing in the law says you have to have a refresher on it, is it? A refresher on that?
No.
No, I didn't think so.
No, but. If you're like me,
yeah.
5 years go by.
I remember.
Can't remember all the details. I got in touch with Maya, and the inspector I had not originally heard about from them was indeed one of their adjusters and is now working on getting a contractor there. The contractor has now looked at the original plans and is they've actually started mobilizing. They should be working on getting the salt shed roof down soon. I know the school's worried about...
I am concerned. The most thing, biggest concern I had is that northeast end where the driving, the big driving door was, that's leaning out big time like that, the wooden structure part of it.
It's leaning worse than it was.
It's leaning out a lot.
Yeah.
Man, if some kid ever got wandered up there or something, that thing comes down to kill him.
So they're moving on that. We should expect to see somebody there pretty soon. Yeah, right.
It's a good idea Ron leaves the cones up during the day when they're not in there to keep people out of there.
Oh, yeah.
And I hope that the school has told their teachers not to let the kids wander out there because...
Oh, I'm sure.
I was told there a while ago, a couple of weeks ago, that one or two of the kids were out there seen in that parking lot. And that's not good.
Mm.
Not good at all.
Yeah.
Should we reinforce that maybe with the principal?
I can.
I would. Sure. Like to see that.
Yeah. I'm sure that if she heard that there was any kid there, she would do something extreme.
I'm sure she probably would. Well, she's not in right now.
Really?
You can't talk to her because she's out for an operation on her.
Oh, no.
Leg or arm or shoulder or something.
Is she? Yeah.
She's out for a few weeks, I heard.
Oh, call her.
Her assistant's taking off.
Okay. For the next meeting, which, as John said, is Wednesday, Lynn Carey will be in at 6 p.m. I've set the meeting for 5:30 just to take care of a couple of things first.
Will this possibly be postponed? Because the storm's not so good. It's supposed to get over till 4 o'clock Wednesday afternoon?
I think we'll have to call that as we see it. It was really hard to get a date for her to come.
Yeah.
So if it's at all possible, it would be a good idea. But yeah, we'll call that.
So we're starting at 5:30?
We'll call that as it comes. Yes, she will be in at 6 p.m., which is going to be the joint meeting with the Finance Committee and the Conway Grammar School Committee. She's coming back from a meeting in Eastern Mass and will have to come back to the area early even for a 6 p.m. meeting. I tried to make it 5:30 based on your need to get out early on a Wednesday, but 6 was the earliest she could do it.
Yeah. I will also be coming back from a meeting in Eastern Massachusetts.
So
we're not meeting at 5, it's 5:30.
Yeah, it's 5:30 there. And there are a few items to go over before 6, including an update from the church on progress toward insurance and repair. Because of the community preservation funds that went to it, there is a restriction on how they do things, and the town has to approve a report from a restoration qualified architect or engineer, as well as look at the insurance claim. And if it is impossible for it to be restored to its historic condition, then the town can get the money back that it put into it. If it can be, then that's what the meeting's about. And so there will be a discussion once they get their insurance straightened out, and once they get a report from an architect, we'll have a joint meeting. Of course, they want that to happen as soon as possible because the building is still shifting, as they say.
Oh, wow. It's still shifting.
It's not... the bell tower seems to be enough away from the original building. And I made it clear that... I checked the document, and they can and should do any emergency repairs that are necessary to protect the building or to protect public safety.
Right.
So they can do any of that without our approval. There will be an Eversource public officials dinner March 30th. This is them talking about their emergency programs.
That's right, we got to sign up for that, don't we?
All are invited. It's in Hadley.
Okay.
We got individual.
Isn't that the 29th?
I think you're right, John.
Ooh.
I think that's the 29th.
You got it written here somewhere.
All right.
Eversource, yep, Wednesday the 29th at 4:30 p.m.
Yeah, in Hadley.
29th, sorry about that.
You're using last year's calendar again?
Well, that's the after action meeting again?
No, the Eversource meeting.
On the 29th, they called it an after action meeting, but I don't know.
It's their emergency response plan.
They want a response meeting. They want a response before we show up, right?
Yes.
I'm
RSVP.
I had RSVP to them. Did you send us the, Tom, did you send us that?
Yeah, you should have gotten it directly from them.
I think we got it right from Eversource.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
Okay, then it was right from Eversource.
So we have to individually.
Yeah, I have it as the 29th.
Individually
too.
Sign up for it. Okay.
Yeah. You do it online.
Yeah.
Do it online.
At 4:30.
Yeah.
Right.
Or it's, yeah.
And I offered if they wanted any comments from us in their program. I offered that to them.
Good.
Eversource, in entirely different news, Eversource is requesting town support for their rate hike. Or at least a positive reference. I have the formal request on next week's agenda.
Didn't we do a good job in the rate hike?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm not surprised. But.
Requesting town support for rate
Edgar hike. Alejandro was not shy in saying they have this docket. You know, they do. This is their docket.
What's the docket number?
Don't you know they don't include the... The docket number
it's a DPU
on their
docket.
Mailing.
Is there a title?
This is, they sent something out about the public hearings, which start on March 22nd and go through April 26th. So there's plenty of time. But they're out here, they're in Springfield. Oh, they're in Greenfield April 26th. That's the last one. At 7 p.m. So they are... This is their 28% in the delivery costs.
28% increase?
28% increase in their delivery section?
Yeah, remember I asked you about that and you said that's a... It's almost 10% overall. Is 8% or something overall increase in the bill, which would that would throw off the budget a little bit. So they're looking for a positive recommendation of what a great
28% increase in delivery charges.
Yes.
Wow.
Right now, my delivery charges are more than
them
I'm paying for fuel.
Yeah,
delivery is about, 10 or 11 cents now.
So food, I don't know, it's yeah, my
so
food...
28%
kilowatt hour
is 3 cents.
It's another $35.7 million in their revenue. Well, if they're going to send... A dozen trucks out to every town with a tornado. I'm gonna need it.
I'll look up the docket on that. Get the info from the docket. Okay.
So that's that. A snow day has been declared for tomorrow. The latest update has the storm swinging a bit further west than before, hitting western and central Massachusetts hardest instead of central and eastern Mass, and a blizzard warning issued from 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. So over the afternoon, the forecast got worse for here.
It is.
Bob will be glad to know that the Highway Department has advertised for a laborer position.
I will be looking.
You can see the
list. I could certainly use it.
You're going to apply?
No.
There you go.
You probably wish tomorrow you had that employee.
Yeah. The listing is on both the homepage and under employment slash volunteer.
But whether they're forecasting where tomorrow is, and the plow truck driver gets around his route once, it looks like he's never been anywhere.
They're saying 2 inches an hour.
Back to the beginning, it looks like he's never been there.
2 inches an hour. I can't imagine.
2 to 4 inches an hour.
Right now?
Could be four.
Thank you, Tom. Concerns of the selectmen? Do we have any concerns tonight? Hearing none, we'll go on to mail. Okay, the mail, let's see, we got mail from, okay, this is Frontier Regional Public Hearing on the proposed budget for Tuesday the 14th at 6 p.m. That probably will not take place.
That has been rescheduled to Wednesday the 22nd, is that? Yes, Wednesday the 22nd.
Okay. And, okay, this is the letter about our meeting with them on Wednesday night.
With the school committee?
With
Lynn?
Yes,
great. With Lynn.
That's just the 16th.
Right, 16th.
I just got another copy of this.
It's supposed to be the 15th.
I was going to say, that says 16th, though.
Yeah, they're wrong.
The 16th is a hearing with the Conway Grammar School, at the Conway Grammar School with the Grammar School Committee.
Right, that's not our meeting on the 15th.
That's not, yeah, that's, we're invited to attend that meeting, just in case. There were questions we didn't get answered the evening before. Yeah.
Got a letter from the Land Trust. Talking about a bicycle path. Self-guided. Okay. Application deadline is May 15th for grant decisions.
So they have a route for it, or they're just looking at where could we put one?
File for a grant to work on a bicycle path.
Yeah.
All the bicycle paths in the forest have all gone away all of a sudden.
Yeah.
We have a notice from FERCOG about the climate change adaptation, a focus on Franklin County. Local official workshop series for fiscal year 2017. Light refreshments will be served.
You said some Thursday night, I believe. This Thursday or a week from Thursday, something like that.
My God. I have to make the calendars bigger. All these meetings.
So that's March 30th.
So this is the one on March 30th that we referred to earlier? Or is this a new one?
That's a new one.
I have this one on my phone, but I didn't have the other one that you talked about.
The Eversource?
Yeah, the Eversource.
Well, that's because that's the 29th. I must have been looking at that and writing about the other one.
Because I don't have the Eversource one in my phone. I don't know why not, but I mean it's...
Well, I'll forward it to you.
Oh, no, the after action meeting, I do have it there. But I didn't, I couldn't find the, anyway, I'll talk to you later.
Community Action is having a focus group on March 30th.
Just the one you were talking about, then?
Climate Action Adaptation Focus on Franklin County, or something different.
Isn't it got the Conway's Covered Bridge on it?
Hmm.
This is from Franklin County CPR.
That's your
group.
Yep.
The Bernie after the loss
group. So being tax season, our group wanted to have a talk on taxes. So it was sent to all the select boards, and as well as it's open to anybody who wants to come. But it's a talk on. It's another look at the state taxes and federal taxes.
Right.
And where the money's going.
Right.
Every time we look at them, they go down.
Better not look then.
Return to the towns goes down.
That's right.
Yeah.
Okay, that's all the mail we have. No other announcements. Next meeting will be this Wednesday, the 15th, in Town Hall with the Finance Committee, and we're having the superintendent school. There.
And the Conway Grammar School.
And the Conway Grammar School. Did everybody get their copy of the Beacon?
Yep.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah, stick those things back in there.
Let me hold on to them for just a minute.
Okay. Okay, any other business come before the board? If not, I'll make a motion to adjourn. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.